Mr. President, I came to the floor to talk about the Abolish ICE movement and reasons why that is a misconceived idea by some on the left, but I feel compelled to respond just briefly to some of the comments made by our friend from New York, the Democratic leader. First of all, the Democratic leader says we need to have hearings on the matter of Russian interference with our elections. Well, I would remind the Democratic leader that we've been doing that for a long time, ever since the Intelligence Community assessment was released at the end of the Obama administration, documenting Russian meddling in the election. And that was released on a non-classified, unclassified basis, so it's on the Director of National Intelligence website if anybody wants to read it. Also, I would submit to him the indictment, the 29-page indictment that Robert Mueller had issued by a grand jury against 12 Russian intelligence officers, lays out in minute detail what the Russians were doing to try to cause confusion and undermine public confidence in our elections. And as a matter of fact, this afternoon, the Senate Intelligence Select Committee on Intelligence is hearing from some Obama administration officials on why they didn't do more to stop it back when President Obama was in office, when they knew very clearly what was going on, but did not do, well, virtually did nothing to stop it. So I would say to my friend from New York, the Democratic leader, there have been a lot of hearings, and the hearings are ongoing. And obviously, Special Counsel Mueller has issued this indictment. I only wish that it was more than a name and shame exercise, because there's no chance the Russians will extradite these intelligence officers over here for a trial. But I think it does serve a useful educational purpose by pointing out with minute detail what the Russians have been up to. They have upped their game in a way that is surprising to many people, using everything from propaganda to social media to cyber theft of information, like the Clinton emails and the DNC emails during the course of the last election. And it's gotten very sophisticated, and we better be about fixing it and getting ready for the next election, rather than coming down here on the floor and engaging in the favorite Washington pastime, which is the blame game. Senator Schumer says we need to issue sanctions against Russia. Well, I have in front of me about two single-space pages of actions that we have taken since the beginning of the Trump administration to support our allies against Russian aggression and to punish Russian misconduct, whether it's in the elections or otherwise. And I would entertain, I'd understand the senator from Colorado has some additional sanctions that he thinks would be appropriate. And I think that would be something that would sting, rather than just send a press release or try to message this or use it for partisan political purposes. Let's consider additional sanctions that will actually discourage and hold accountable the Russians for their election meddling and deter them, hopefully, from doing it again. But then I understand the fourth thing that my friend from New York said is we need to stop criticizing the Comey FBI and the Department of Justice under the Obama administration. Well, it's pretty clear from the investigations that have occurred that something rotten was happening at the leadership of the FBI. And just to listen to Mr. Strzok and his protestations that there was no bias associated with those investigations, it's patently unbelievable. It's unbelievable, not credible. So I understand that the Democratic leader wants to focus his attention on the president, and that's his prerogative, and indeed he's been the leader of the anti-Trump resistance since President Trump was elected. And many of us do disagree with the president's assessment on of the intelligence, as I've suggested, I firmly believe that there is solid evidence of Russian meddling in the election. I think that President Putin misrepresented the facts. I'm not surprised at that, given who he is and how he operates. As the Democratic leader said, a former KGB colonel, he's accustomed to dissembling and distorting and manipulating information in a way that serves his purpose. But I do think we should be absolutely clear. We all support are the men and women who are the professionals who make up the intelligence community in this country, many of whom expose themselves to great danger, and indeed many have lost their lives trying to protect this company against adversaries around the world. And I do think that the findings of the intelligence community assessment during the end of the Obama administration provides a roadmap to what the Russians did, as did the indictment of the 12 Russian GRU intelligence officials. And we better wake up, and rather than the blame game and pointing fingers, we better get ready for the next election, the midterm election in 2018. So I think there's a lot we can do together, but as long as this becomes a political, partisan, stop Trump at all costs effort, I don't think we're going to make much progress. So I just want to conclude this part of my remarks by saying I trust our intelligence community. I trust their assessment that there was Russian meddling in the election. But I also trust the investigation so far, which has shown absolutely no collusion with the Trump campaign and Russian intelligence activity leading up to the election. That's what I think has got the president so spun up, is because he feels like this is an attack on him personally. And I wish we could separate those two. But indeed, our Democratic colleagues don't want to separate those because they realize that this is the best way to keep this story going for as long as they can through the next election and, who knows, through the next presidential election as well. Mr. President, I just want to say a few words about this misguided effort to abolish ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement. This is the operational component of the Department of Homeland Security. We've seen this movement on hashtags, on Instagram, on T-shirts. We've watched protesters that showed up in California when ICE agents were trying to investigate the trafficking of children. Can you imagine these protesters interfering with an investigation into the crime of human trafficking of children? But that's not all. Some of the House Democrats have introduced legislation to eliminate ICE. Of course, any sensible person would tell you that eliminating ICE is reckless, which is why I recently introduced a resolution with 14 of our colleagues denouncing these radical calls in the strongest of terms. This is just reckless and naive, this abolish ICE movement. It's a move that would be fundamentally irresponsible, and based on one recent poll, close to 70% of the American people, when asked about it, oppose the idea, and for good reason. ICE was created, after all, in 2003 in response to the discovery that many of the 9/11 hijackers had exploited our holes in our immigration enforcement and overstayed their tourist visas and attended flight schools without a proper visa. And we know what happened there on that terrible day, 9/11/2001. We know that hundreds of thousands of foreign nationals overstay their visas every year illegally. And without ICE, those unlawfully residing in our country in violation of their visas would be allowed to stay indefinitely. Is that what the Abolish ICE movement is about? Is eliminating enforcement of our immigration laws and allow people who flout those laws to succeed in staying here in the United States in violation of those immigration laws? Of course, abolishing ICE would mean ending all of the agency's programs and functions. It would mean allowing dangerous criminals, including potential terrorists who are in our country, to remain here. It would mean scrapping the ICE Cyber Crime Center's investigation of child exploitation online. It would mean ending the ICE Blue campaign to rescue human trafficking victims and provide them with a safe place to stay and other services. The Blue campaign was just authorized by Congress, by the way, unanimously this year, and abolishing ICE would eliminate it. Abolishing ICE would mean doing away with the unit that focuses on human rights violators and war crimes that is currently pursuing close to 2,000 leads. It would eliminate initiatives like Operation Community Shield that combats the proliferation of transnational criminal gangs. So I hope our colleagues understand what they are encouraging when they say we should abolish ICE. I think it's incumbent on them to explain their rationale to the hardworking officials who are on the front line fighting against human trafficking, child exploitation, and illegal immigration. What do they have to say to those people who risk their safety, perhaps even their life, to enforce those important laws, much less to them whose jobs would be on the line? There's some important statistics relating to Homeland Security investigations, which is a critical part of ICE, that our Democratic friends who are encouraging the abolition of ICE, that they should know about. 8,887, that's the number of visa applications that Homeland Security investigations refused based on terrorist connections or other derogatory information. 904, that's the number of sexually exploited children identified and or rescued by Homeland Security in 2017. 3,945, that's the number of cases initiated based on human smuggling last year. 4,735, that's the number of transnational gang members arrested in the United States in 2017. And 980,000, which is the number of pounds of narcotics Homeland Security investigation seized in 2017, which included thousands of pounds of deadly drugs like fentanyl that helped fuel the opioid crisis. ICE plays a leading role in all of these areas. If the critics get their wish and ICE were abolished, the numbers for all of these items would be zero because Homeland Security investigations could not exist without ICE. There's more. Think about close to 33,000 criminal arrests made by Homeland Security investigations last year, 90 criminal arrests each day. Without ICE, these criminals would still be on the streets endangering our communities. And the $524 million in illicit currency that was seized, it would be back in circulation, being used in illegal transactions. And 7,000 pounds of heroin, 57,000 pounds of methamphetamines, and 260,000 pounds of cocaine were impounded last year. That would all be back on the market and being sold, poison being sold in our communities. So I hope our colleagues who are calling for the abolition of ICE are prepared to explain their reasoning for abolishing an agency that combats illegal drug sales and online exploitation and helps protect our nation's borders. My respectful suggestion would be they need to spend a little more time thanking these public servants for the critical role ICE plays in keeping all of us safe. Maybe they should spend a little time getting to know them, the ICE officers who go to work every day and do their duty protecting our country. Earlier this month, Vice President Pence talked about this. He reiterated President Trump's words of support that the men and women of ICE are incredible people. These include more than 20,000 investigators, field officers, special agents, and analysts who the Vice President said stand up for the rule of law in our nation. Every day, ICE confronts criminal illegal immigrants who endanger our communities. They fight vicious gangs like MS-13 and stop human smugglers and child traffickers, and as I said earlier, sometimes endangering their own safety. In 2017, the Vice President pointed out attacks on Customs and Border Protection agents increased by nearly 75%. Deliberately fostering resentment and anger and contempt for ICE and our other law enforcement officials obviously puts our officers in additional danger. And this is reckless, not to mention, again, dangerous. The ICE critics try to justify their calls by pointing out the situation at the border to certain families that were separated but are now in the process of being reunited. Well, we all agree that these families should be united, and I know the presiding officer has authored important legislation to change the law to make sure that families are kept together when they come across the border and claim asylum. But then their case is processed on an expedited fashion in front of an immigration judge. So if they have some legitimate claim to asylum or some immigration benefit, they can get that heard. But also one of the objectives, of course, is to eliminate the failed catch and release policies of the past, which have done nothing but encourage additional illegal immigration and awarded the criminal organizations for whom this is their business model, exploiting gaps in our immigration laws. And unfortunately, when we have members of Congress that resist fixing those gaps, filling those gaps, solving the problem, it does nothing but enrich these criminal organizations for whom this is gold. So, Mr. President, it's clear that the situation at our border is a crisis. President Obama in 2014 called it a humanitarian crisis when tens of thousands of unaccompanied children came across the border. And that continues today because we haven't fixed the problem on a bipartisan basis, even though solutions are readily available. Those who've criticized the enforcement of our immigration laws, the so-called zero tolerance policy, have focused on separating families. And so what we have tried to do, since we all agree that families should not be separated, is to provide a means for them to stay together. And those that once separated should be reunited and detained in appropriate facilities and have their case heard on an expedited basis before an immigration judge. Not doing that, not fixing the problem, will just simply encourage more of the same. And unfortunately, as I said, our colleagues who refuse to be part of the solution actually are part of the problem, because we know who wins in this game. It's the criminal organizations that are, as one pundit said, one expert I should say, said, they're commodity agnostic. They'll traffic in children, they'll traffic in guns, they'll traffic in drugs, anything that makes them a buck. And this is a very, very lucrative business model for them. And unfortunately, when we don't fix the problem by plugging the holes, we are unwittingly helping to support that business model. Mr. President, I yield the floor.